come back and give me some things and like clothes, and he used to give me money, and we used to go out and have a few drinks. This is a friend, Silo, who passed away with age, you know. And we just, all the time when he saw me in Johannesburg, he was so happy to see me. You know, and I really loved him a lot. Because when I was in YMCA, when my mom and dad were in America, he used to come up and he'll ask me if I'm alright all the time, that time when I was living in Hillbrow. And so we went out to nightclubs quite a bit, you know, but one day he wasn't there, and I had my school bag with me, you know. And when I went into this nightclub, I met these two guys, and one of the guys had a knee brace, you know, tightened around his knee, and he had a knife there, you know. So I thought nothing of it. I thought everything would be all right, you know. So they started buying me a few drinks and everything. So they offered me to go back to the hotel to have some drinks. And the hotel was called Chelsea in Hillbrow. So I went up with them, you know, two guys. And they, when we went up there on the lift, they opened the door, said okay. Both of them started lying down on the two single beds, and I'm standing up just looking at them, and I said to them, what's going on? I thought there was drinks. You know, and the guy says, no, we're going to kill you. And I thought it was a joke, you know. I said, oh, yeah. And the guy actually pulled out the knife, and he tried to stab me four times. And I was really lucky that the door was actually open, because if that door wasn't open, I would have been dead. So I had to run out, run through the hotel, trying to shout, open the door to each and everybody, and they wouldn't open the door. So I had to find my way downstairs, so I ran away. So I got away that time, you know. And then in the middle of the night, I met Stanford. It was like 2 o'clock in the morning, and he said, come back to my flat, you know. And then afterwards, we woke up in the morning, and he was a very close friend of mine too. What actually happened, it was a week later, so I stayed at his, and he used to steal gold chains for a living. He used to rip it off people, scrap and run, what they used to call it. So he done that, so he had money. So I went with him, and I used to stand at the corners, you know, when he used to do it. And he showed me how to do it. And I only done it once or twice, you know. And then afterwards, 1 week later, he was going to a post office, and he saw a guy with a gun, and he was waiting in the queue, and he tried to grab the gun off the guy, and the guy took the gun out and shot him, you know, in the body. So I wasn't there, but that's what I heard. And then afterwards, I saw his brother in the in one of the pubs, like the pub, we call it clubs over there. So his brother said to me, Raymond, I've got bad news. Your best friend died, a good friend. I mean, most of them were my best friends, but I mean, he was close to me too. I mean, when he just got shot, I just cried, you know. And inside of my heart, it just felt, why are all of these guys dying so quick? Because it just happened one after another. And then afterwards, it was a couple of months later, I had another friend in Zola. That was in, I think it was in Zola too. It was a township in Soweto. And this guy, he used to work in Johannesburg. I used to meet up with him. and we had a few drinks together. I used to sell things in Johannesburg, and then afterwards one day he went home and he was sleeping in like a garage. They have their own bedrooms, like a bed sit. Bedrooms in a garage, they had their small stoves. So he woke up one morning and his girlfriend was inside, and someone knocked on his door, and then afterwards he had an argument with his girlfriend about quite a while ago, but they were separated. So he woke up one morning, and when he opened the door, they actually shot him outside where he was living. And then afterwards, the same thing. I saw his friends at the club, and they said, Raymond, we are very sorry your friend got shot dead too. You know, and I'm just saying, wow, this is unreal. You know.
What sort of age were you then?
I think I was about 18, 19. So it was just heartbreaking just seeing them go, and then afterwards with Gary, what actually happened to Gary, the one who used to work with my mom, he never actually died the first time, but what actually happened, his next door neighbor was very jealous of him, but he was a womanizer, you know, Gary. He used to sleep around with lots of women. And he was going through an alley, and that next door neighbor actually stabbed him in the heart. But it was so inches of a blade that when he was stabbed, he nearly died. So he spent like 3 months in hospital, 3 or 2 months to recover. And when he came back to work, he said he missed me and everything. I missed him too. And then I still went out with him to different places. He was still alive. And then my other friend Medisa, he died in the car accident, you know. Mm. But I really liked him, but I couldn't stay awake with him. I mean, because he used to be up 72 hours, 48 hours, you know, going stealing. And he used to say, come on, it's not time to go to bed yet or anything. So we used to go out, and I remember the time that we were out in Johannesburg. He actually took a break, and he broke the car window at the back, you know, to steal a car radio. That time you could get a lot of money for car radio. So he told me to wind the window down. So I wind the window down, and he told me to jump in. So I never wanted to jump in. So I said, no, the best way I'll get out of this, I'll just open the door to let the alarm go off, you know. So I opened the door and the alarm went off. So all of them were starting to run away. So I ran away. So they went back again to see if there was any danger, you know, that they can just get the car radio. So I waited at the bottom there because I never liked to do that stuff, you know. But there was a time I used to rob people and make for a living. But I regret it, but that's only way we could live there. Us, we would get no food. And then afterwards, I just heard Medisa died. And he bought himself a nice car and everything. The tire came off on the highway, and his girlfriend died with him. And just the feeling. I can't explain it when these friends died, because they were so close to me, like a brother. They gave me everything. And the one who I worked with for 7, he loved me too, but I think he's still alive. I used to go out with him every day, sell watches. We used to buy watches for £10, sell it for £30, you know. I mean, there were big chances. I mean, I remember the time when I was in Hillbro and I was with these guys, and they said, let's go in this taxi. And I never knew what was going to happen. So there was these two girls and this guy. They said, we're going to Livingston. There was another township. But I knew this guy before, so I said, oh, I'm going to get drinks and everything inside the township. Everything will be okay. So I went in the taxi, and then the guy who was sitting in front of me, he actually pointed a gun to the taxi driver, and he said, give me the car keys. And the taxi driver wouldn't give the car keys. So the guy actually went around the car, and he tried to take the guy out the car. And the guy, the taxi driver, managed to steal the gun off the guy, and he shot him in the leg. And I started running, and all the two girls were running, and they were screaming, help, help. You know, and I mean, I was in dangerous stuff, you know. You just learn from that experience by seeing crime doesn't pay.
You're talking about what yourself?
Yeah. I mean, of these people doing these things, they don't live a long time. They don't live a long time at all, because they, I mean, like in the townships, it's a waste of life sometimes, and that's what made me so upset, seeing these people dying in it, you know, people robbing each other, killing each other, hijacking. You know, it's not life. And I know another guy, his name was Panda, and he told me to go and knock on the door in the suburbs, the house in the suburbs. In, I don't know where it was about, I think it was in the center or somewhere. The guy with a shotgun, and the guy tried to shoot it, and they had to jump back over the wall and go back to the location, and then they got some money, and then they drained it, and they all loved me. They even used to steal money from the pub inside the township, when the guy says, oh, I'm off to the toilet, and the guy went around and they just started stealing beers, just putting them on the table. And the guy wouldn't know anything, or he was too scared to actually say something, you know, because the guys I was with, they were carrying knives. And, you know, I knew a guy called Teboho. He was a good friend of mine too. He used to carry a 9mm 15 shooter. And when he says, see, my nickname was Bongani. So all the time when I walked with him at night, he said, carry my gun for me, because he was afraid of the cops, you know. He was saying, oh, you're a white guy, they won't suspect you, you know. And afterwards, police stopped, and I threw the gun away. Because if I got caught with the gun, I don't know how many people got killed with that gun. If the police find out maybe there's three people killed with their gun, I'd be done for murder.
Yes.
So that's why I threw it away, and then afterwards we found it at the end when the police came. Then I remember when I was with him, he said before he died, he gave me some drugs to put in my sock, you know. And the police stopped me and they searched me. They never found anything, because they never searched me properly. They only stopped to a certain point, you know. So that's what happened. And I used to have lots of girlfriends. lots of friends in Johannesburg who were prostitutes.
Yeah.
And they looked after me too, but most of them passed away because of AIDS. They were just dying of AIDS and that. And they used to give me food every night. They used to buy me drinks. So that was my life. It was just going on in circles.
How many people do you think you did lose?
Oh, quite a few. I'd say about 10.
Yes. Over how long period?
From, I would say, I'm talking 1990, I lost Gary, I lost Medise, I lost Cello, I lost Tebaho. That's another guy I never mentioned. Tebaho used to, the one I think he had the Mercedes Benz, he died. He was a dangerous guy too, but I think he just died of a heart attack. But he was a lovely guy, but he was confused in his mind, but he had a lot of money. They had beautiful houses, and they wanted me to rob a casino with him. So we went to go and look at the casino to go and rob. So it never worked. So it just changed their minds, you know. So that's what happened. But just, you know, I think it was about 10 of that died in South Africa. Because, I mean, I can't even remember how many of them died who I knew. Because Tebogo died too. You know, he got shot. And, you know, and then Matisse's friend, he died. And I don't know what happened to him. I think he got stabbed. And, I mean, all over where I went, I just saw friends die. It was just like, oh, that one's dead. Did That's you, life there.
Did you know? Go to the funeral?
Yes, I did. Mm. I went to a funeral, but I'm going to be honest, I only went to one because it really made me upset.
Yes.
Because if I went to the funeral, I mean, I had a soft heart and I would have just cried. Even Cello's, I was too scared. I was here in Scotland, but when I heard over the phone, I cried for 2 days. I couldn't, because he was so close to me. I mean, just I loved him. Even when I went back there in 2005, I saw Cello's mom in it, and she said they were asking for me. When Cello died, you know, and Cello even said, "Where's Bob Lanning?" And I need him, you know. And I wasn't there that time for them, you know. So, and then Teddy, the one who got shot from the police woman, that was really sad. He helped me so much too. He.
Did you see that happen?
No, I never saw it happen. I just heard, it was in the newspaper and everything.
Yes.
You know, yes. But I still went to go and see the mom, so and then they loved me to bits. We were just sitting and she was talking to me. And that's when I had the interview on TV in South Africa. And I was in the newspaper about why did I live in Soweto? Was the reason. It was because they were really good to me. I mean, that's all I can say about my friends. I just wish they were still here to tell you the story.
Yes.
You know, because I think they would love to tell you the story about me. And that, you know. I think the seven, he's still alive, and most of the families are alive. So when they get there, I think it's going to be really good to see them again. And I will be going soon.
You talked almost as if you'd only happened yesterday.
because I talk that way because I don't forget it, and I love them so much. I don't want to forget it. I don't want to forget my friends. I wish I was with them forever. It's in my brain all the time.
Do you sleep well?
Sometimes. Not all the time. It's because I just wish I was still there with them. South Africa, I think it's changed a lot now, so it's okay, but I mean, when I'm in Soweto, no one knows me now, hardly, but the ones who I love, I think they know me, you know.
Yeah.
I think they all know me, so that's it, you know. So I just have to move on in life.
Okay, that's great.
Thanks.